Nanam paramam dheyam. Knowledge is supreme.
Welcome back. So here is the summary of the expressions which we have derived for step response of a second order system, and depending on whether we are in the regime of overdamped response, critically damped response or underdamped response, we will get these type of responses. And you can see that the nature of these expressions are very similar. The first term AKP gives you the ultimate value of the response. Then we have a constant 1, and then we have a decaying function e raised to minus zeta t over tau, and then lastly we have either a hyperbolic cosine sign or a linear function 1 plus t over tau, or a sinusoid of the form sine of root of 1 minus zeta square t over tau plus phi. And all these cases, what you should notice that if I take the slope of this response at time t equal to 0, that slope is going to be 0. So the response is not directly start at t equal to 0. So there will always be a zero slope at time t equal to 0, and slowly the response will catch up. So this is again a distinguishing factor between a first and a second order response. In first order response, the response directly starts with a non-zero slope at time t equal to 0, which was 1 over tau. And in second order system, the system takes little bit time to get started, and that is why the initial slope is going to be 0. So now we'll see how these responses look like with the help of the manometer example. That was the example we had considered as a inherently second order system, and depending on the values of parameters of the manometer, we can make the manometer to behave as an underdamped system, critically damped system or an overdamped system. So let us look at it through a simulation. So let us start with how the response looks like when we have a overdamped response. So for that, these are the parameters of the manometer, and the only thing which we are going to change is the radius of that manometer. We will see that by just changing the radius of the manometer, we can move it from one type of second order dynamics to the other. When we take the radius of this manometer to be 1 10 to minus 4, we are going to get overdamped response. So let us see what are the parameters we get. We get tau is equal to 0.3194. We have zeta which is greater than 1, which is in fact equal to 14, and the gain value is given here. In that case, this tau square will be 0.1, and the intermediate term will be 0.944. So we'll enter these values as a second order response system. The gain goes here. This is the tau square twice zeta tau and 1. And when we see the response of this system to a step input in terms of the pressure drop, we increase the pressure by this amount of Pascal or 10 kilopascal. What we would get is the response of this system. You can see that the response goes from initial value to the final value. Here you may not be seeing what's happening right in the beginning, but if we zoom in, we will see that the response has a slight zero slope in the beginning, and then slowly it kicks off. Now when we look at the critically damped response, in that case we will be increasing the radius of this manometer, and if the radius goes to 3.7 10 to minus 4, you will notice that the damping coefficient becomes almost equal to 1. The tau and kp remain the same, and if we put that value here, we will see that the response has sped up significantly. It looks similar to the previous response, but the only difference is it becomes a little faster. And when we look at the response when zeta is less than 1, in that case the radius, let us say radius goes to 9 to the minus 4, we will see that the damping coefficient in that case becomes 0.1728. See that the response of the system has oscillations which decay over time, and that is the typical response of a second order system. So this is how even a single system, just by changing a parameter, we can move from overdamped to critically damped to underdamped. So let us now look at these responses in more detail and what is the effect of these parameters. So here are the responses when we are in either looking at critically damped or overdamped response, and you can see that as the damping coefficient is very large, the response becomes sluggish, or it is more and more, it is slower compared to a critically damped response. Critically damped response would actually represent the fastest way to go from the original point to the final point and staying there. So this is how the response would change when the damping coefficient changes. You can see that as we are reducing the damping coefficient from the value of 3, the response is getting pushed towards the origin or towards the y-axis. And as we move past zeta equal to 1 and go into zeta less than 1 territory, we'll start seeing that that pushing towards the origin actually moves the response above 1. So the response is gonna overshoot the value, the ultimate value. And what we are going to see is as the damping coefficient goes beyond the value of 1, we'll have oscillations, the damping oscillations. If the zeta value is closer to 1, the oscillations are not that significant. And as the damping coefficient value goes much lower below 1, you will see that the oscillations are quite significant. And we had seen last time that if the damping coefficient becomes 0, then these oscillations do not die and you will be getting a case of sustained oscillations. So that is how these responses of a second order system change as we change the damping coefficient right from a very high value to a very low value close to 0. Now the second order response underdamped response or critically damped response, they will play a very important role when we are designing a control system. Let us say for an example, we want this response which we are seeing right now is a response, the underdamped response is the response of a controller which is trying to move the parameter, let us say this is a scale temperature, from the original steady state value to the final steady state value, which is given by the scaled value of 1. So in that case, what we would want is the response, or the controller should move the response from original value to the final value as soon as possible. We would also want that the value should stay there. We would also want that it should not overshoot by a large amount. So in order to do all those characterizations, many a times we prefer to have an underdamped response of the final system plus controller, because in that case what we see that the response reaches quickly to the neighborhood of the ultimate value. Even though it does not stay at the ultimate value, it reaches in the neighborhood of that value much quickly compared to either critically damped or overdamped system. So if when we make a change in the set point, the controller reacts very fast, it takes you very close to the final value. Even though it oscillates around it, we are still very close to that final value. And because of that, what we are going to get is the system will move to the new stay close to the new steady state, and even though we have some oscillations there, we'll try to minimize those. So typically we would want to have an underdamped response, and in order to use this response for controller design, we need to define some of the parameters of a second order system. So let us look at what are the different parameters which characterize the second order underdamped response. We'll start with the first one, which is a rise time. So if we draw the second order response, this is the ultimate value. What we are going to get is the response . So this is a typical response of a second order system, and the rise time is defined as the time corresponding to this point. So this time is known as rise time. So it is the time when the response value reaches the ultimate value. So ultimate value was AKP. So the response reaches the ultimate value for the first time. It may not stay there, but it is the time in which it reaches their first time. So if it is a controller, then we would want this rise time to be as small as possible, because we want to move from original point to the final point as quickly as possible, so that our operating point has shifted. It may not have stabilized, but it is still shifted to the new point. The next term we define is known as an overshoot. So as an underdamped response overshoots the final value, we want to quantify how much is the overshoot. So we quantify that as, if we measure this as A and if we take the ultimate value to be B, then the overshoot would be defined as A over B. So it tells you how much fraction of overshoot is happening inside the system. And if this is a controlled system, again we would want a low value of overshoot, because we don't want the response to go much beyond the designed final value. So our designed operating point is, let's say, AKP. We don't want this A to be much different from that, because there may be some physical limitations, whether the system can not go there, or it may be that, let's say, if this is a reactor temperature, there may be some safety limit in terms of the catalyst which is used or explosive conditions. So you don't want to move too much away from the desired operating point. So typically in a controller, you would want this overshoot to be as low as possible. And then the third term which we define is known as a decay ratio. So it tells you how these oscillations are going to decay. So if I take this as C, then the decay ratio would be defined as C over A. So it tells you how quickly these oscillations are decaying. Again, if this is a controlled system response, then I would want, or we would want, that as we have reached the ultimate value, you would want these oscillations to decay very fast, so that the response ultimately reaches that value and stays there. So again, from a controller point of view, you would want a low decay ratio. The other term which we are going to define is known as a response time. So response time typically is characterized as the time by which the response has reached within the plus minus 5% of the ultimate value. So as the response is oscillating, we'll have to wait for infinite time till it reaches exactly equal to AKP. But all practical purposes, we can say that if the response is between 95% and 105% of the ultimate value AKP, as soon as this sinusoid enters this particular tunnel, we will call this as the response time, and this is known as the response time. Again, if this is a controlled system response, we would want this response time to be as low as possible, because in that case we would have final stabilization of the system to the new operating point in the quicker time. So, and lastly, the parameter which we define is the period of oscillation, which is a very fundamental characteristic of any sinusoid. So, if we have this as a sinusoid, then it will be the difference between any two successive peaks. So, this will be the period of oscillation. So, we have made some comments here in terms of if this is a controlled system response, then what do we require? So, what we would want is a low rise time. We would typically like low overshoot. We would also want low decay ratio. And we would also want low response time. But if you recall the responses I had shown you for underdamped system as we change the damping coefficient, if I want a low rise time, if I try to push the response towards origin, then these oscillations are gonna get bigger. So the overshoot is going to rise, increase, as well as the response time is going to increase. So, there is always a trade-off when we are trying to design a control system that if we want a low rise time or a quick response to the new steady state, then obviously I have to live up with a larger overshoot or decay ratio. So, we'll be looking at more of these when we look at a control system design, but here I just wanted to give you some glimpses of what kind of trade-off is going to exist when we are trying to design a response for a second order system or a controlled system which behaves like a underdamped response. So summarize, mostly what we have seen is a second order system, most of the times we would be getting it as a series combination of two first order capacities or first order systems. Very rarely we would have something which is inherently second order. Out of these parameters, gain has the same significance as that of a first order system, where it signifies the magnification of the input. The damping coefficient represents how much it represents the resistance to the oscillating behavior of the system, and we have seen that it has a very strong effect on the dynamic response. The response may show oscillations or may not show any oscillations. The critically damped response is the fastest way to reach the ultimate value without overstepping it or overshooting it. If we are okay with overshooting, then the underdamped response will be a faster way to go there, but may not. The ultimate value may not stabilize there before the critically damped response. And lastly, I have not given you a significance of tau yet. So it is a tau, we had called it as a natural period of oscillation. And when the damping coefficient becomes zero, we have shown that the system oscillates with the radian frequency of 1 over tau, or the overall frequency of twice pi tau. So when damping coefficient is equal to zero, then we had shown that the response oscillates, and the final period of oscillation, so this is period of oscillation, in that case is equal to twice pi tau. So tau has a significance in terms of the period of oscillation when there are sustained oscillations. Also known as natural oscillation, and therefore this tau was known as the natural period of oscillation. So we'll stop for the second order systems here, and in the next lecture we'll look at the higher order systems. Thank you.